Hello, my name's Nick Thody. I'm the head of knowledge at Osborne Clark, and I'm joined today by Catherine Hammon, who is our Digital Revolution knowledge lawyer. So Catherine, thanks for coming along. We're going to talk a bit today about artificial intelligence, or as it's always known, AI. And let's kick off with the question that begins all conversations about AI. What is it?
So broadly speaking, artificial intelligence is simply machines that can perform human tasks. And that's a hugely wide category of things. But when people are talking about AI at the moment, what they're normally talking about is machine learning, deep learning. It's artificial intelligence which can actually learn and get better, self-improve, if you like.
Now, unfortunately, I'm old enough to remember the first time that artificial intelligence really engaged the public imagination, which was at least a couple of decades ago. And then it seemed to go quite quiet, and you know, AI didn't really feature much in the public debate or the business and legal environment either. But in the past few years, it's really come back, and you know, I think you know through your work, and we know as a firm, that it's at the forefront of a lot of businesses' minds. Why the sudden resurgence of interest in AI?
So you're quite right that the actual computer science research and understanding which underpins what's going on at the moment is a couple of decades old. The ideas around deep learning, this concept of neural network, which is a form of programming inspired by the human brain, that was generated in the sort of by the 1980s, it was all in place, but it didn't really work in practice. And so we moved into what's known as the AI winter across the 90s and the early 2000s. But what was happening in the meantime was Moore's law, computer processing speeds were increasing and increasing and increasing. The internet was invented, we got much wider connectivity, we got mobile connectivity, and those things combined started to generate a lot of data. So we have now the phenomenon of big data. And fast processing, cheap processing, plus also big data were essentially the magic ingredients which were needed to make these theories work. And so in about 2012, all of a sudden, this stuff started to work. Someone had another go and it worked. And so that's why now there's this sudden resurgence of commercial interest in the whole topic, because now it's actually working.
Okay, so it's one of those great examples in the tech world of two or three developments, in this case, the way Moore's law works, big data, and the great steps forward in connectivity that have kind of brought about this AI renaissance. So you made an interesting allusion there to learning like the human brain learns. So can you tell me a bit more about how AI software does actually learn?
Yeah. So what happens with AI, with deep learning techniques, is that you give it a set of data and it mines through the data, it searches through the data, and it finds patterns and correlations. And it then is given feedback to tell it essentially how good those correlations are. And based on the feedback, it adjusts to produce a better outcome. And then you give it more data and it adjusts, and you give it more data and adjusts. And so essentially it's honing in on the right answer over time. It can feel like magic sometimes, because it can produce very clever outcomes, but actually it's all maths driven. It's all based on maths.
And so that maths driven sort of data crunching approach, what are the typical tasks that AI is being used for?
Yeah, there are three main areas where AI has great commercial potential. Pattern, finding patterns in things. Now, if you can find a pattern in something, you can also spot an anomaly. If you can find a pattern in something and you understand the sequence, you can make a good prediction as to what's going to happen next. So those kind of pattern-based functions are very important and are very significant. The other two areas, which don't feel like patterns, but actually they are, one is natural language processing. So being able to understand ordinary spoken language, ordinary written language, rather than the sort of fixed commands that you have to give older types of software, fixed voice commands, just normal language. And the other one is image recognition, whether that's 2D, 3D, static images, video images, etc. So those are all sort of spotting patterns, spotting similarities, and getting the right answer.
So from that, I kind of assume that the things AI is less good at are those that involve subjectivity and judgment. Is that the case?
Yes, absolutely. That's absolutely right. What AI is pattern-based, it's statistics-based, it's maths-based. It doesn't have a broader understanding of the big picture. It sees things in detail, it sees the patterns. It can't really handle things which aren't pattern-based, so it doesn't have any common sense. It also doesn't understand the actual underlying concept of what it's talking about. So there's a really neat example to explain that. There's an there's an algorithm which was given a whole load of information about recipes. So it learned what recipes look like, how they're structured. And when it started to produce its own recipes, one of the instructions was cut the water into cubes. Well, if you know what water is, you know that that's nonsense. But it didn't really know what water was. It just knew that water was the kind of noun that you find in recipes, and cut it into cubes was the kind of verb you find in recipes, and it put them together. But it demonstrates the point. It's got no common sense. It doesn't see the big picture. It doesn't have this understanding of the concepts it's handling. It just recognizes the patterns of that word, normally goes with that word, etc.
Okay, so the drawbacks are, you know, it's operating with pure logic and without a framework of sort of common sense and the wider picture. But I guess we've all worked with people like that as well. So those drawbacks are not just limited to AI. Now, you know, I think being quite skeptical about some aspects of artificial intelligence, but just can you briefly outline those areas where it really is outperforming humans, you know, at the moment?
Yeah, I think some of the key things that it can do are to do with the speed of processing. So when we're thinking about a question, there's a limit to how much data, pure data, we can hold at the front of our minds in order to process and manipulate. AI doesn't suffer from that limitation. So where it's to do with finding answers across data, doing research, that kind of thing, AI in many fields is starting to be able to do a better job than human beings can. It can do it normally faster than human beings, and it can very often do it cheaper than human beings.
So just extrapolating from that, what are the sort of concrete tasks that we're seeing AI being deployed to do at the moment?
Yeah, so following on that line, for example, there's a well-known example of an algorithm which was given a whole field of research, medical research around cancer, and it was shown that data and left to form its own patterns and correlations. And from that research and understanding, it was able to match the medical recommendations which had been given to real patients in real life scenarios. It was able to match 99% of the recommendations, and in 30% of those cases, it was able to recommend further treatment, which the consultants had missed. In the legal practice field, there are examples where artificial intelligence search engines or artificial intelligence document analysis tools have been quicker than human beings at processing certain basic analyses and basic research functions.
So that's all fascinating background, but of course, and just stepping back, you've obviously got a fantastic job title, and we've kind of covered the digital revolution bit, but there is a lawyer bit at the end of your job title. So let's just go into that and the legal issues that AI throws up. What are the sort of three headline legal issues that we have to think about when AI is deployed into a business?
Yeah, so the point which normally comes up first in people's minds is the issue of liability. Who's responsible for this stuff? And in particular, that comes from the fact that AI can generate unexpected results. Now, as you know, if you're going to be found negligent, then first of all, there has to be a duty of care. It was your responsibility to be careful about this. And then there has to be some harm, but there has to be a link, a line of causation from what you did to where the harm was caused. And it has to be reasonably foreseeable that harm could have happened, and that's what engages your duty of care. Now, if there's an artificial intelligence algorithm sitting in the middle of that chain of causation, sometimes the outputs which it generates, because it's taught itself and it's learnt itself and it's formed its own views about the patterns and the patterns and correlations, sometimes those outcomes are not expected at all. So, for example, AlphaGo, which is a Google algorithm which plays Go, the strategy game, the first time it beat the human champion, one of the winning moves was so unexpected that people assumed it was a malfunction. Right. Now, if you've got that kind of left field output coming along, does that break the chain of causation? So there are questions like that. Other ways to deal with liability in relation to, for example, driverless cars, where you've got artificial intelligence algorithms controlling the car, probably insurance will cut through the problem. They'll just cut through the Gordian knot by putting insurance in place, and the person who's insured the owner of the vehicle will be responsible through the insurance process. Other ways that you might deal with the liability problem. In land law, there's a principle that says that if you bring something dangerous into your land and it escapes and then causes damage, you have a strict liability to be responsible for that. So it may be that we go along those lines. So liability is one of the big issues of how do we deal with it.
So just following that example about cars on, which is very interesting, because obviously, you know, autonomous and driverless cars is one of the main deployment areas for AI. You say that the owner of the car might be responsible for ensuring the outcomes. That strikes me as quite odd, given that how the car performs will be buried deep in the software, which is presumably designed either by the manufacturer or by some third party, and the manufacturer is then incorporated into the car, that the liability falls on the owner or the driver of the car. Is that kind of developing as an industry position, or is that still out there as a topic for debate?
Yeah, I think at the moment, it's an interim position, I think, is probably the answer. So as we move into testing of autonomous vehicles on the roads, the government decision has been essentially to extend the existing insurance framework, whereby the driver of the car is responsible for any accidents that are caused. And so at the moment, that's going to be what happens. I mean, of course, there's always the situation that you need to make sure that the victim, the person who suffered the harm, is compensated, and the insurance point deals with that. But the insurers themselves will want to make sure that the person who is actually responsible pays, ultimately. And so these questions of who was responsible, was it the software programmer, was it the manufacturer, who, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah. So at the moment, the government's attitude that the driver or owner is the person immediately responsible for the insurance position is kind of a classic example of the law developing from established precedent into new areas, which of course we're familiar with. So liability is one of the big legal issues. And what about bias? Because this is a sort of often overlooked area, which is very interesting.
Yeah, bias is really important. So the concerns around bias come from the fact that artificial intelligence has to be trained on data. Now, if the data itself contains bias, artificial intelligence has no common sense to spot it for itself. It just sees patterns in what it's given. So the bias will be replicated, and the bias will be embedded into the patterns which it's found. And so garbage in, garbage out. If you put biased data into an algorithm, it will generate biased outputs. And there are good and well-established examples of that happening. Sometimes the bias is actually illegal. So if it's generating racially biased outputs or sexism or any of the other forms of illegal bias, illegal discrimination, then there's a clear problem. Sometimes it's a bit more subtle than that. Perhaps it's a recruitment algorithm that's biasing towards a certain type of education, etc. There may well still be a problem in that scenario, although it'll be dealt with legally.
So those sort of cultural and unconscious biases, which aren't in any way illegal, they're just a product perhaps of the programmer's own background and upbringing, they can go deep into the way that an AI piece of software is going to function. Yeah. And how are developers of software, what are they doing to sort of combat that kind of issue?
Well, there are suggestions that you can write AI to correct the AI itself, right. So you can teach the AI to spot the problem. It feels like a bit of a, yeah. I mean, essentially it's one of these societal diversity issues. The more different types of people you have inputting to these processes, the less they'll be biased, the more there will be a well distributed set of views and opinions, etc. So part of it is a sort of industry drive to make sure that there is a less limited type of person involved, broader types of people, different backgrounds, different cultures, etc., etc., to try and drive variety in what's going into the data. And also, you know, bias in data is not a new topic. That's something which economists, statisticians have dealt with for years and years. So it's making sure that you apply the proper rigor to your data set to make sure that you that you weed out the bias at the outset, so that the data that goes into the algorithm is good data.
Yeah. So we've got bias, liability, and I guess any conversation about any topic to do with the digital revolution has inevitably got to come back to data, the ownership and uses of data. And absolutely, I think I can see how that's going to engage with the AI debate, but you will be better at explaining.
Well, you're absolutely right. If it's digital, there must be data involved. And if there's data involved, there's data privacy, et cetera, issues. Data comes, the data issues come in many angles. First of all, the data that you're using to put into your algorithm, you need to make sure that you've got the correct permissions to use that data. If it's images, et cetera, you need to make sure that you've got the copyright licenses, et cetera. If it is data which is personal data, etc., you need to make sure that you've got consents from the individual concerned. There's a clear example already of where a medical AI algorithm was being trained, and medical patients' data was given to the algorithm owners to use to train it up. And the Information Commissioner's Office said no, that was an illegal transfer of data, because the patients hadn't expected their data to be used essentially to train a commercial product. They'd expected it to be used for their own for their own treatment and potentially to inform the treatment of others, but they hadn't expected it to be used in this different context. So you have to be very careful that you have the right consents. The other thing to remember is that it's generating data, and there are protections under the GDPR, the General Data Protection Regulation, which comes into force in May this year. There are protections there around automated decision making, decisions being made on the basis of automated profiling, etc. And where those decisions are having a legal effect or are significantly affecting you, you have the right to have some kind of human involvement in that process so that it's not completely just automated. Generally speaking, the principle of privacy by design is really important. So make sure that you design your algorithms from the outset, to be compliant with your data protection obligations, etc. Both the data going in, the data going out, the way it's used, etc.
Brilliant. Well, thank you very much for that brief run through AI and the legal issues around it. I mean, personally, I think it's one of the most interesting areas of modern law, and you know, as we've touched on, in many cases, existing law is being used to develop the legal principles that will govern AI, but in other areas, sort of completely new thought is going to be required. It's a fantastic run through, Catherine. Thanks very much.